distinguished webinar series. And what's very important for us, Mr. Kundu, today is that tomorrow we celebrate our Foundation Day on the 20th of October. And last year we had a very big public function, at least 150 people were here. But this year, because of COVID, we actually wanted to invite our Honorable Shiksha Mantri Ji. He was even interested, but COVID ki wajah se kuch nahi ho raha hai. But I thought that at least we should commemorate the day by inviting a very important person such as yourself, and not only an important person, but one of India's foremost experts on water. So I'll come to the subject in 2 minutes, but I just wanted to use this occasion to once again go back to those days in 1965 when Indian Institute of Advanced Study was founded by our second president, Dr. S. Radhakrishnan. You recall that India had just come out of a war with Pakistan in 1965. And in fact, the world itself was not in that great a situation. We had a Cold War going on between the so-called free world led by the United States and the so-called Second World, which was the socialist world, which was led by the USSR, the former USSR. And at that time, despite the war that we had just come out of, and there was also food scarcity, if I remember right. I remember, I was a very young boy, but I remember, I was hardly 5 years old or less, but I remember the slogan coined by our Prime Minister, Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan, Prime Minister Shastri, Lal Bahadur Shastri. So under those conditions, and Nehru Ji had passed away in 64, Shastri Ji had become the Prime Minister, we had had a war, and even in spite of those adverse circumstances, President Radhakrishnan wanted a place in India, like All Souls in Oxford or the Princeton Institute of Advanced Study, where we could reflect in a dispassionate and deep manner on problems confronting humanity, the human race itself. The Cold War was something that was, so important, so, I would say, threatening to the very survival of the human race, because we were, as a human race, we were on the brink of a nuclear standoff, which continued right till, I suppose, President Reagan's term in the early 80s in the United States, after which, the Soviet Union collapsed, the Berlin Wall fell, and so forth. And today, I think that when we're going to talk about water, I want to focus on why water is so important. We have always heard, it's become a cliche, that the next war will be fought for water, not oil. We used to think that, the wars in the world were over oil, and we saw that in the Gulf Wars presided over by George Bush Sr., then his son, and the conflict ongoing in the Middle East, even today, Syria, Iraq, and the rest of that very volatile zone. And a lot of the fighting is over oil and who controls the oil resources of the world. But I was reading this book by a very important expert called Stephen Solomon. It's called Water, the Epic Struggle for Wealth, Power, and Civilization. And I think Solomon makes the argument that though the last 100 years, oil has dominated some of the global conflicts in the world, or at least the last 50, 70 years, if you look back at the history of human civilization, the most important resource has been water and not oil. And you know that the greatest ancient civilizations were riverine civilizations, the great Egyptian civilization on the banks of the Nile, the civilizations on the banks of the Tigris and Euphrates, in the ancient Levant, the Mesopotamian civilization, then the Indus Valley, Saraswati civilizations, which then moved eastwards to the Gangetic Plain and the Doab, what we call the Doab. And of course, the great civilizations of ancient China, which were built along the Yellow River. And then later, Cambodia, Vietnam, many other great civilizations with huge buildings and achievements. were driven, as it were, by rivers and by water. And Solomon says that only, 2.5% of the surface water of the world is actually potable, drinkable. And already we see that some people say that the conflicts in the Middle East are not just over water, but they're climate wars, they're climate conflicts, which have resulted in huge displacement, refugees. And these refugees have, in a way, penetrated into Europe and caused a certain number of conflicts in Europe as well. If you look at what happened in Paris just the other day, the beheading, the horrific beheading. If you look at the background of the gentleman, or rather the person accused of that crime, who was then shot dead, he was not from Europe initially. So these are, so to speak, displaced people. They're climate refugees, and climate refugees are driven by water scarcities. So Stephen Solomon's book is worth reading. And he says, consider what will happen in water-distressed, nuclear-armed, terrorist-besieged, overpopulated, heavily irrigation-dependent, and already politically unstable Pakistan, with its single water lifeline, the Indus River, loses a third of its flow from the disappearance of its glacial source. So I'm quoting from this book, and this brings us right to the heart of our topic, closer to India, where we are in an eyeball-to-eyeball conflict with China over Tibet, in fact, which is where most of our perennial waters, not rain-fed waters, but perennial waters come from the Tibetan plateau. Not only the Sindhu, from which we get our name, Indus, India, Sindhu, Hindu, but Brahmaputra, which is an even bigger river, as Sanjayji is going to explain to us. It's the biggest river system in our subcontinent. And all these great rivers originate from Tibet, and we are now in an eyeball-to-eyeball conflict in Galwan and the Five Fingers and so forth with China. So now let me come to our topic and India's waterman, because this is how I would describe Sri Sanjay Kundu. He's an IPS officer of great repute, but yet his passion is water, and he served for a considerable number of time in the water ministry. And we hardly know that the years, or should I say decades-long conflict over Kaveri between Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. I come from Bangalore in a way. And, you know, this is the thing for which people would burn buses routinely, you know. In Kolar and elsewhere, there would be fights with its large Tamil population. There would be demonstrations in Chennai. So Kaveri water was a source of, you know, decades-long conflict in India. And one of the most important players in the Kaveri water resolution, we've forgotten about it because aajkal har saal wahan riot nahi hota. I'm just giving an example, is Mr. Sanjay Kundu, who worked behind the scenes. And I found out, you know, some of the things which are not in the public domain because he visited us soon after he took over as DG Shimla, in fact, Himachal. DG of police, and I found out that he was a very important player in resolving this. Remember the Narmada dispute? I used to be, when I was in IIT, we were a part of a group there, and we used to meet Medha Patkar and, you know, the Narmada Bachao Andolan. And at that time, we also believed that the Narmada projects with the huge dams, you know, were not in the national interest. I mean, it was the 90s and we didn't have all the data at that time. And it's only when I saw the water coming to Saurashtra, I saw the water and I saw the difference, because we were always told that Saurashtra mein pani kabhi nahi pahunchega and it's all a fraud. And then, you know, the chief minister of Gujarat, Narendra Bhai Modi, actually did it. And he covered the canals to reduce evaporation with solar panels. Ye sab jo maine dekha, then I asked Medha ji ke, aap to keh rahi thi pani kabhi nahi pahunchega Saurashtra, and so forth. But in resolving this dispute, you remember that the dispute was over the height of the dam, you know, the amount of water to be blocked, and the doob kshetra. You know, these were the terms we used to hear. I mean, how much of the dam would result in the destruction of the habitat as well as displacement, etc., etc. Again, Mr. Kundu played a very important role. And we don't realize that when bills are passed in parliament, even if ministers table the bills, there's a lot of work behind the scenes as to who writes out the bill. Who is it that is drafting it? And the dam safety bill of 2019 passed by the Lok Sabha, Mr. Kundu played a huge role in drafting that bill. I hope you don't mind my saying these things. I don't know whether they were supposed to be public or not, Mr. Kundu, but you must allow me that liberty to really bring out your achievements, because you're so modest, I know that. But our fellows and listeners need to know some of this. Then the Interstate River Water Disputes Amendment Bill, again, a very, very crucial bill, tabled in 2019 and passed in the Lok Sabha. I think Mr. Kundu had a stellar role to play in that. And one last thing I'll mention, there was a 3,500 crore World Bank project on dam safety. It was actually called DRIP. And to get the approval from the World Bank for the second phase, because, you know, there was silting and there's a huge amount, as you rightly said, of science, technical details involved. There's a lot of debates on the, you know, on the utility of big dams. They say big dams are actually very destructive, et cetera, et cetera. And there's so many NGOs working against them with so much funding to stop some of this. So for funds to be released, you have to have very good submissions to the World Bank with, you know, the best science which can stand scrutiny. And, 11,000 crores for DRIP 2, 3,500 crores for DRIP 1. And once again, Mr. Kundu has been instrumental in drafting these, getting them passed. In addition to having served in the mission, in the National Water Mission as the director, he's been director general of the National Water Development Agency. He's been chairman and managing director of the National Project Construction Corporation, which is a mini Ratna PSU. He's been the chairman Brahmaputra Board. Now, if I had time, I would tell you about the one evening notice he had when, before the PM visited Assam, Guwahati, to get a report on this. And Mr. Kundu worked all night. And next morning at 11:30, in the meeting with the PM, he had all the data ready to present to the PM. He was, of course, Joint Secretary, Public Policy, Water Development, and Peninsula River for the Parliament and so forth. So, a very distinguished civil servant in our midst today via webinar. And we are very honored to have you, Mr. Kundu. And I must say that for us, your lecture is of great importance because it coincides with the celebration of our Foundation Day. And one of our mandates, as I said, was not only to reflect deeply, you know, on problems besetting the human condition. Water is certainly one of them. But we've taken it upon ourselves to reflect and to discuss the post-COVID world. You know, can it be a better world? Can there be an alteration in our patterns of consumption and distribution of resources? Can we conserve the resources of the planet? Can we be better custodians as human beings? And what IIAs can also do in terms of influencing policy, in terms of putting out the knowledge about this. And the last thing I wanted to say is that when we spoke, you told me that even the linking of the waters in India is, Mr. Ramaswamy, who used to be the secretary in the water ministry, he used to tell me, I'm talking about the 90s, because that was the time I was associated with some of this. And he said, Makarand, it's a very difficult thing because you have to pump water or drill across the Vindhyas and so forth. It's really not practicable. But again, you told me that, yes, it can be done. So, mumkin hai, this kind of attitude of yours is also very encouraging. And we want to know both the art and science of water, because hydrology is really a very deep subject. And I think we are ourselves 98% water, I'm told, 90+% water. So, on that watery note, I invite you, Mr. Kundu, to take us through the water resource management of India and the challenges that we face and the way forward. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Pranjpe, speaking very good words about me. And I'll just begin. We'll talk about water resource management in India, challenges and way forward. Right in front of you in the presentation, I'm trying to give it in presentation form because there's too much of technical data and it's a science. And if we don't use the presentations, you might not get the exact figures, data and all that. So I'll run through the presentation. It's about 35 to 40 slides, but you'll find it interesting. And after the presentation, we can have an elaborate question and answer session. So right front in front of you, you see the basins. B1 is Indus, B2A is Ganga, B2B is Basin 2B is Brahmaputra. But we'll come to that. Now,
next slide, please.
Yeah. Once. Okay, so we are talking about India's population and water resources. India has 2% of world's land. We are 3.29 million kilometers square and 4% of world's freshwater resources. This is largely due to Himalayas. Himalayas are also called the third pole. People say if Britishers could understand the value of water, they would have never left Tibet, because that is called the third pole that provides about 30% of fresh water to the world. We have 17% of world's population, that is around 1.3 billion, and 15% of world's cattle population. So we have huge population, small land, and some water resources. So let us come to the area. Cultivated area is 47%. Non-cultivated plus wasteland is 30%. Forested area is 23%. So that makes 100%. But out of the cultivated area CA, irrigated area is 37% of CA and rain-fed area is 63% of CA. But irrigated area, as it is common sense, produces 55% of our food grains, and rain-fed area produces 45% of our food grains. So that is largely the snapshot. Now, let us come to the water statistics. How much water do we receive every year? We receive 4,000 billion cubic meter. It can be also called kilometer cube. And out of this, 75% is during the monsoon, about 3,000 billion cubic meter. Average flow in rivers, we basically classify water as surface water and groundwater. So river flow is about 1953 kilometer cube and utilization is 65% of that. Groundwater is 433 kilometer cube, that is under the ground. And total utilizable water is 1123 kilometer cube or billion cubic meter. So this is a figure that we must remember throughout the presentation. Now, let us come to the per capita water availability. If we divide the total utilizable water by a population, we'll get the per capita. So it is 1545 meter cube per person per year in as per 2011 census. But as our population is increasing, by 2050, it will come down to 1090. I'll come to that. So basically, it's a finite resource. Water follows a hydrological cycle. It doesn't disappear. We get 4,000 billion cubic meter of water. Out of that, 1123 is utilizable. But as our population is increasing, the per capita availability of water is going down. And by the year 2050, it will be pretty serious. Next. Nitya? Nitya Gumbran? There's some technical glitches, but it's getting hanged.
But we can see you and hear you very clearly.
Okay. Hang on. So basically, India has so much of population that say UP is the size and population of Bangladesh. Rajasthan is the size and population of UK. So we are basically with the same kind of water resources and geography, we've got so many countries together. Next.
Your slide is not moving, but you are very both visible and audible. Only the slide is not moving.
I don't know if Ritika can run it.
Yeah, we have the slideshow. I can also suggest that we all run it on our own. I also got your slideshow.
Ask the system analyst to share it.
All right. मेरे पास तो आ गया है. या तो अश्विनी जी आप ही स्लाइड शो रन कीजिए साइड बाय साइड. अदरवाइज वी डोंट वांट टू मिस योर प्रेशियस वर्ड्स. वी विल ओपन द स्लाइड्स ऑन आवर ओन. मैंने तो खोल दिया है. माय पावर पॉइंट इज ओपनिंग नाउ. सो वी कैन proceed on our own with the slides, okay. And in the meanwhile we listen to you.
So the next slide is basically population of Indian states compared with countries. So in fact all our states are can compare very well with the countries. So if we compare basically countries of almost our size and our kind of geography and population, Australia, Brazil, USA, so they have less number of people, more land, and population per square kilometer, that is density, is much lesser. So next we go to the topography of India. So the map in front of you is the Indian topography. We can classify our rivers into four systems, basically Himalayan rivers. Himalayan rivers are big, they are glacial fed, they have snow fed, and then they also have rains. Then there are Deccan rivers. Deccan rivers are largely rain-fed. Then there are coastal rivers. They are along the western coast and eastern coast. They are very short lengths. So they also get huge rainfall. But because they have very short length, all the runoff is to the sea. And lastly, we have rivers of internal drainage. These are smaller rivers, but they are within the country. So our huge chunk is largely because of Himalayan rivers. Deccan rivers are also considerable, and coastal rivers, we cannot enjoy the fruits of this. So if you go to the next slide, basically this talks about spatial and temporal variability of rainfall. Yes, you can see it. Kindly hold this. So the issue with India is that unlike the Western countries, we don't get rain throughout 365 days of the year. We largely get our rains during the monsoon, which are 4 months of the monsoon. And mostly it is between 5 to 150 days, and most of the rains is within 15 days or 100 hours. If you see the graph, basically most of the rainfall that occurs is between June and September. So that will be a blessed country. We get 1.17 meter of rainfall every year. The world average is 1.11 meter. Maximum is in the northeast, and minimum western Rajasthan is akin to the deserts of Arab. Next, kindly. So if you see the land use, that way most of our land is arable. We have got about 23% of forest. We have small plantations and some areas where we have scrubs and grass, and the unproductive land in India is very, very small. We are blessed that way. You can see it's largely Leh Ladakh, that area, but otherwise most of the area is productive in India. Next slide, please. Now, this is the basin map of India. This is very important, and I'll spend some time on this. If you see the top 73 is the Indus Basin. So that is the kind of water we have in Indus Basin in India. We are not talking about Indus Basin as Pakistan. It is much more, and the Indus Basin in China. So Indus Basin is 73. 525 is the Ganga Basin, large Ganga Basin. That is why we had such huge populations which were supported, because the water availability was so much in Ganga Basin. The largest water availability that we have is in Brahmaputra, 598 billion cubic meter. This is around Dhubri. So if you go to Guwahati, it is about 573 billion cubic meter, and 25 billion cubic meter is Barak. So what is of concern is that we have huge water there, but we are not able to put it to much use. Then the whole peninsular area is 430 billion cubic meter. Now, what is to be understood is this peninsular area supports huge populations, say Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Andhra, Maharashtra, but the water availability is very limited. And then we have this coastal region, Western Coast, Western Ghats, which receive a lot of rainfall. It is one of the highest in the world. But most of the water goes into the sea. So that is largely the snapshot of how much rainfall we receive and what our basins carry. So again, I want to reiterate that most of our water is in the east and north. It's largely because of Himalayas. It's largely because of glacial melt. It's largely because of snow and rainfall. As we go towards Vindhya, the rainfall is the only source of water. Next. So if you see, this is just a tabular description of what I have described so far. You see, Ganga, Brahmaputra, Barak, it has got the maximum water. Utilizable is only 40%. West flowing rivers, you can't, as I said, it goes into the Arabian Sea, you can't utilize it much. Other basins also have limited water. So as I told you, there is over space, as I told you, over space, this is the distribution over space, over geography. Earlier I showed you over monsoon, that is over time. So our problem in India is, although we are very blessed with a lot of water, it only occurs in 4 months of the year. Secondly, the water is concentrated towards north and northeast, and it is not equally distributed in the whole country. So these are two issues, spatial distribution of water and also temporal distribution of water, with which we have to live with. Next, please. Okay, now we come to groundwater. As I told you, the total groundwater that we have is 433 billion cubic meter. And because the Himalayas give so much of water, a lot of it gets absorbed in the ground. So the Himalayan region or the northern region has a lot of groundwater also. When you go towards Deccan, India, the groundwater is 41 billion cubic meter. Brahmaputra, Indus, Krishna, they also have about 26 billion cubic meter every year. So the thing with groundwater is that on account of rainfall, there is some runoff which goes into the river. Some is absorbed by the soil. What is absorbed by the soil goes into the groundwater. So there are two aquifers. There's one aquifer which gets charged every 100 years. And there's one aquifer below that which gets charged in 1,000 years. So that way, we got enough groundwater resource as long as we don't misuse it. But groundwater, because it is easier to use, has been the main reason for our green revolution and also urbanization and also our industrialization. Let us move on to the next slide, please. So if you see, our groundwater usage is highest in the world. It meets 85% of rural domestic requirement, 50% of urban water, and more than 65% of irrigation requirements. That is why you find tube wells dug everywhere. And there has been a proliferation. You can see the slide and you can also see the table. There has been a proliferation of groundwater structures. In 1951, we had 3.9 million groundwater structures. In 2001, it became 18.5. 2009, it is 27 million. And 2013, it is 31 million. So Every square kilometer, approximately, there are 10 structures. A lot of these are used for irrigation. A lot of these are used for domestic rural water supply. A lot of these are used for urban water supply. So most of the growth in India has taken because of groundwater usage. But the problem is, are we using it or overusing it? Now let us go to the next slide, please. See, we thought that groundwater was the golden goose that we could use. But I think we became greedy. We started abusing it. As a result, you can see red areas. These are overexploited groundwater areas. So out of total, say, assessment unit of 6,000 overexploited units are 1,034. What does overexploited mean? Basically, every year, groundwater gets recharged because of the rainfall. Okay, if your extraction is more than recharge, what happens is your groundwater levels will go down. So that is what is happening. Where we are extracting more than what is being charged, that has become red. And that has become very serious, because what happens is when you hit the lower aquifers, you are likely to meet radioactive materials like uranium, like other radioactive materials. That is why in places in Punjab and Rajasthan, where they have gone and hit the second aquifer, there are huge cases of cancer. This is true for districts like Ganganagar, Bathinda, southwest Punjab, parts of Haryana also. So what has happened is, because of over-extraction of groundwater, they have hit the second aquifer. That is a cause of worry. Then there are 92 assessment units which are saline. The water is not potable. You can see that unless we are able to control our groundwater exploitation, we might lose this precious resource. And if we overexploit the second aquifer, it's very unlikely that it can get recharged. So this is the situation of groundwater in India. We started off very well with groundwater, but then we started overexploiting it. And as a result, the overexploited blocks are becoming more and more. And 162 overexploited areas have been notified for regulation. Actually, you cannot put tube wells there, you cannot put industries there, because the situation is so bad. So we can move on to the next slide, please. See, when we talk of water, there can be no talk without water power. We say India is blessed with a lot of rivers. Why don't we extract power out of that? So our total potential is 149 gigawatts. And we have exploited, or today we have 45 gigawatts exploitation. So that is, development is 31%. And most of the development has happened in Indus Basin. That is why when you go to dams like Bakhra, Pong, Ravi, all these have been dammed. And there is hydropower from there. Ganga Basin, the number of dams is not much, the hydroelectricity is not much, because I think they ran foul of the environmental laws. If you remember 2013 Uttarakhand massive flood, it was because they had not kept environmental laws mindful. Now, when you go to the northeast, as I said, the maximum flow that you have is in Brahmaputra and Barak. That is why that is the basin which has the maximum potential. But you see, it has got 66 gigawatt potential. Only 4% is exploited. For the simple reason, there has been no decision on where to dam it, where to dam the Brahmaputra, and where to build power plants. So as a result, Brahmaputra is sort of a virgin as far as hydropower is concerned. And then we come to, say, this region of Orissa and, say, northeast. Out of 15 gigawatts of potential, 7 has been utilized. So all in all, we can say that India has huge potential of hydropower, but we have been only able to utilize 31% of it. So there's a problem here, because most of the dam sites which were usable, which were identifiable, have been developed. Now, if you try to build more dams, that leads to environmental degradation, leads to basically movement of a lot of people. So today the society is not able to accept that. Second thing, what has happened is the cost of construction is so high, cost of land acquisition is also high, forest compensation is so high, that newer technologies like solar energy, wind energy, they have also started producing power at comparable or cheaper rates. So that is why there's a pause in this. In a way, we can say that we have not been able to exploit fully our rivers as far as hydropower is concerned. But we have done whatever we could do. Now we go to the next slide. I'll just take some time to explain you this. As I said, that normally we have river flows for about 4 months. So if you see the slide in front, so there are irrigation demands. Irrigation demands are based on 75% dependability. And then there is domestic, municipal, and industrial demands. So you can see that if you combine both of them, irrigation demand and say human demands, outside of the monsoon, you don't have enough water to even meet that. So that is why storages are extremely important. Storages can be above water, storages can be below water in the form of aquifer. It's like having a house and having water supply in the house. If you get enough water, there's no need for a tank. But if you get water only for some time in 24 hours, you need to store the water. The storage of water can be over like gravity, or it can be underground, then you can pump it. Similar is the case with the country. What I want to tell you is that, except for monsoon, the flows in rivers are not enough to meet our agriculture demand and our domestic demand. That is why you need to have storages. All smart countries, all countries which have developed, is largely because they have storage of water. It is also the same there, most of the countries, that they don't get equal water for 365 days per year. That is why you have to create storage. It's like bank. Say I get salary only once a month, but I put it in a bank. Then I use it throughout the month. And I also save a little for the rainy day. The same is the case with water. Whatever water profile I've shown you, how it is distributed over space and time. Having said that, you need to have storages so that you can have water throughout the year, and you can also have water for bad monsoon years. Next, please. So now we go to what is per capita water availability. So there was a Swedish female scientist by the name Falkenmark. What she said was the average is normal is 1,700 meter cube per person per year. World's average is much more, 7,600. So that is the European standard, so we are not bothered about it. But water stress line is at 1,700 meter cube per person per year. We have already hit 1,545 during the last census. And water scarcity line is 1,000 meter cube per person per year. That is the condition of Pakistan. Pakistan has already hit that figure. So they are a water scarce country and we are a water stressed country. Next, please. So this is the projection what we are doing. I told you about the resources, the demands, and what are the projections? Say today our demand in year 2010 was 701 billion cubic meter, and our population was 115 crore. So we had enough water because our total water is 1123 billion cubic meter. By the year 2050, as we grow, as India grows economically, as we move people out of poverty, the first thing that they will do is feed their children. So in 2016, when I was in the ministry, the food grain production that year was 280 million metric ton, and fruits and vegetables was around 290 million metric ton. By the year 2050,
storage tanks, from the British created, by the way, big ones, were actually already created by the British. But then in addition, we also got into the act and we've created at least three facilities to store water. And I hope that post-COVID or in slightly more comfortable times, we'll invite you one more time and you can give us, you know, more concrete suggestions on how to store water, especially, you know, water for our gardens. We have huge gardens and obviously, want to use pumped water, which comes from the municipal supply, and so forth. So it was a very enlightening lecture. I did have a couple of comments, but before that, in fact, I was just reminded of the torrential rain in Hyderabad recently. I've lived in Hyderabad, and the Musi River, the Hussain Sagar, Gandipet, everything overflowed apparently. And it makes you think that usually, you know, Telangana is a dry area, and Hyderabad, you get rain only in 3-4 months. But I mean, climate change is a very real problem. And then to manage water in Mumbai, every year the drains get clogged, and the, you know, the trains are, you know, stopped. So somewhere we are failing in just handling, you know, the challenge of water, as you mentioned. But we already have a question, and I'm glad to see it starting with the Brahmaputra. This is from Professor Hazarika, who comes from Assam. He says, thank you, sir, for your informative speech. It is learned that the waterbed of the Brahmaputra is coming upward, as a result of which flood problem in the state is becoming grave day by day. Over and above this, China has reportedly have constructed dams to convert the water of this river, snapping off water resource from the country. What measures do you suggest to solve these two problems? And here's a supplementary question from Dr. Srinivasan K. Iyer. He says, this Brahmaputra is like this ever since my childhood. Nothing or no action has been taken to improve the flow of the water. Instead of floods and submerging the places every year, flora and fauna are mostly affected. If the water is worst in the world, as you said, I don't know what this means. It is not due to water problem, but because of the pollution made by the people. He means the rivers are like drains, I suppose. That's what he's referring to. What kind of action can be taken by the government? Now, before you answer this, I just wanted to emphasize once again what you said at the end. This is not just the government's problem, okay? We are always in the habit of turning everything into a governmental problem. It's our own responsibility. And today, for people who follow these things, is also World Dignity Day in the memory of Pandurang Shastri Athavale. It's his 100th birthday. He's the founder of the Swadhyaya movement in Gujarat and other parts of India. And I've actually gone to the sites of Swadhyaya. By the way, I edited a book called Dharma and Development, where I had a chapter which I myself wrote on water, because, you know, it's organizations like Swadhyaya and also the Swaminarayans. I went to the driest parts of Saurashtra where they hardly get rain, and I saw that every home had an underground water reservoir, you know. And some of these were very prosperous areas, and the way they saved water drop by drop through water harvesting, water conservation. So what I want to say is that it's for us to do this, not just for the government. Public-private initiatives are wonderful, but all over India, we've seen that some of these spiritual organizations have done great service, you know, to build small check dams on rivers, to restore and recharge wells, and to teach people to water harvest in their own homes, so that water that you get during the few days of rain can serve you throughout the year when times are scarce. So please, Mr. Kundu, here's the question on Assam is right up your street, since you had a great role to play in the Brahmaputra Valley project. Go ahead, please.
Thank you, Dr. Hazarika. I'll just tell you the basic facts. As I mentioned in my presentation, the Brahmaputra at Dhubri has a flow of 598 billion cubic meter. That's huge water. In terms of flow, it's the fourth most water in the world. But it also gets 800 million metric ton of silt load. Brahmaputra has 128 tributaries. And a lot of these tributaries are from the north and some are from the south, from Nagaland all. But because it gets so much of silt load, that is why you find a phenomena called braiding in Brahmaputra. Because there's so much of silt load, the river flows like this, deposits its silt, then moves forward. So you are correct, because the Brahmaputra bed has been rising because of the silt load. There's a particular island in Brahmaputra called Majoli, where we started doing a lot of work. Initially, it's the largest inhabited river island in the world. And there's Brahmaputra, there's Sabansiri, and there's three rivers on the side. We found that it had an area of 1,024 square kilometers earlier. But what happened because of this erosion, the area reduced to 500 square kilometers. And we took a lot of steps like porcupine this, then embankment, everything. Now, we did this mathematical modeling with IIT Guwahati also to get to know, like, do a modeling for Brahmaputra. The thing is that the jury is still out. Some people say that you need to build dam upstream so that you can store water there and store the silt there and then release water as has been done in Bhakra and all that. But the problem with Brahmaputra is that Assam is plain and the storages will be built in Arunachal Pradesh. So there have been a lot of talks with Arunachal people, Arunachal Chief Minister. For some reason, they don't agree to storages. Experts say that if probably you can build storages there, then you can reduce the flood level in Guwahati by 19 to 20 meters. There's a particular hydrological observation station in Guwahati called Pandu. I've been there and I've seen the flood there. A lot of experts also say that because of the floods in the wildlife sanctuary, that gives them elephant grass and all that. But with proper releases, that can be managed. My answer to this is the river flow is well known, the silt load is well known. You will have to build storages upstream. The states in question have to agree to some storages. Once you do that, you can control the silt also, you can control the water flow also. About the second question of basically pollution of rivers, it is very correct. A lot of these rivers actually resemble drains now. There is a phenomena in water science, what is called as when you actually get rains, the water from the riverbed actually charges the groundwater. And this happens during monsoons. And in the lean season, what happens is there is this base flow of water. That is why you continue to get water in the rivers. But because of so much of pollution, these base flows in many rivers have stopped. And water pollution is extremely, extremely sensitive subject. Brahmaputra, it's not an issue. It's largely issue in Ganga and other basins. Yamuna in Delhi is almost non-existent because of water pollution. There are no base flows. Now, how water flows in plains is slightly different and how it flows in Himalayas is different. In Himalayas, there are a lot of streams. They say, experts say there are 4 million streams and the water comes out from streams and then the streams join and finally you get the rivers. So what is happening because of our bad practices and our inability to conserve water, a lot of these Himalayan streams are also dying up. So experts are divided. Actually, the Indus water basin flow has reduced because of a lot of construction. When you make roads, what happens is you put a dead end to that streams and the streams growing dry. So that is why historically, if you say in Indus basin, the flows have come down. That should not happen in other this. Flows are extremely important to maintain the health and strength of the rivers. It is accepted that we need to act with urgency as far as quality of water and rivers is concerned, both quality and quantity. There's a phenomena basically when we dam the rivers so much, what we actually do is we stop the longitudinal connectivity. If you have seen the Satluj basin, if you have seen the Ganga basin, you have dammed the river so much. So basically the river is dead between two dams because you take it through the tail race tunnel. So what happens to the flora and fauna there? So there is talk of ecological flow, e-flows now. I've visited a lot of these smart countries like France. They have fish locks, they have environmental locks. They don't make the river dead. But because of our unscientific and sort of a very strange way of developing dams, what has happened is the river is actually dead between patches. That should not happen. River actually means something that flows. But this has happened in many rivers. I've seen in Satluj Basin, this is happening in Ganga Basin. After Tiri Dam, the Ganga is dead for some time. This should not happen. I think we need to work with smartness and seize our water resources and put the best mind to use it because the problems are immense.
Thank you. Thank you. In fact, the next question was also about, the same topic that you mentioned, which is how to manage rivers. It's about linking rivers. And the question is this not a very idealistic sort of project? Because considering the long delays in construction of canals like the Sutluj and the link canals in Punjab and Haryana, isn't this a utopian project? This is by Anjali ji to you, Dr. Anjali Duhan. That's the question.
If you see the chart, there are these were the links which were found possible. Now, this is a big win. It's like a big win. But I think we should start with low-hanging fruits and small wins. The small wins that were possible was Ken Betwa, because the investment was less and the returns were very high. It would have provided water to Bundelkhand, which is very poor area. The second is Par Tapi Narmada. This would have provided water to Bombay city so that it can live and thrive for next 100 years, and also provide water to Saurashtra and other places in Gujarat which are perpetually dry. So let us start from small wins. So actually in water sector, the problems are so many that you really don't know where to start and where to begin. My suggestion is let us start with low hanging fruit, small wins. Let me start with my house, with basically the water storage in my house, you in your campus, and let everyone start with small wins. And maybe 5 to 10 years from now, you'll have something substantial to say. But when we talk of small, big projects, the question comes whether it is doable, whether it is worth it, whether the cost involved is so much. So my suggestion is whatever is doable, kindly start with that. And let us put the big ticket items on hold, but let us start with something which is doable. And an interlinking of projects, two of these projects are very doable.
Thank you so much. Now I'm throwing it open to others. Are there questions? You can unmute and ask directly or send me. Yes, Professor Raju, I see your hand. Go ahead.
Well, that was a very interesting talk, very highly informative. And now when you talk of doability, the thing that seems doable to me is to abandon Delhi and go and live in the Northeast. That is where likely to have the least problems with water for the next few years. But I was wondering, you see, there is also, I mean, there are two things. One is the technological solution, that ultimately, if I have enough power, then I can, desalinate seawater. And this is something that the Arab countries are doing, something that Israel is trying to do, and so on. So, apart from floating icebergs and so on, they are trying to desalinate. And if you do that, it basically requires energy. That may be a permanent solution to the problem, instead of thinking that, if you have so much population, so much water, maybe there is a technological solution. That is one of the questions. And the second question is that our water management also depends upon our prediction of the monsoon, for which we have our traditional calendar, which tells us about our Sawan, Bhado, and so on. But this is simply, nobody pays attention to this traditional technology for judging, anticipating, and using the water during the monsoon season.
Thank you, Professor Raju. I totally agree. There's not one solution. In coastal areas, desalination is a solution. And what is happening, as technologies are improving, the cost of desalination is also reducing. So today, technologies are available where you can desalinate and use it for drinking water. But the technologies are not available where you can actually desalinate and use it for agriculture or irrigation. It becomes too costly. But I think a time will come when that will also be possible. And we are hoping that. So we must make use of what is available. Say technology is one. Secondly, what our minister, my earlier minister Uma Bharti, used to say is, you are too technology oriented. Involve people. They are very key to this. So if you are trying to clean Ganga by yourself, it will serve no end. Try to involve people who are living in the Ganga basin. So that is open defecation free, sewage treatment plant, effluent treatment plant. You cannot run a program from Delhi saying that Ganga is polluted and you have a solution for it. You need to involve people. So it's well accepted technological solutions are possible, and we should look for best technological solution. As far as prediction of monsoon is concerned, the science has evolved much better. But the smartest thing I saw was in Australia. As I said, Australia is water stress. It only gets about 400 mm of water. So they have a meteorological department, which is based out of Melbourne. So that their meteorological department deals with meteorology also, that is weather also, hydrology also, that is water, and tsunamis also. And they also deal with airspace, because Australia is in charge of huge airspace, and it controls that airspace in the Pacific, because that is the only country that is there. So they've got huge responsibility for it. So basically, this convergence of weather, water, say we don't have issues like tsunami, floods, droughts, and say air traffic, I think this is what we see in next 5 to 10 years, because ultimately all of them use cloud data only, whatever is there in the clouds, no? That data that you use. And I totally agree, we need to get smarter in our prediction, and we also need to get smarter in our technologies. But a word of caution is that we need to involve people, ultimately. That is the place from where we'll find lasting solutions.
Can I ask a supplementary question? I fully agree with you that people should be involved, that we cannot just have technology devoid of people. That's not my idea at all. My idea is technology itself is going to turn into people. All right. That is a different. I mean, that people will turn, machines will turn into androids, which will be part human and part machines. So I think I see that convergence there. I agree with you that people must be involved. The people are involved in a very simple manner in which Uma Bharti would talk about it. However, when we're talking about prediction, see, I was with CDAC, and CDOT, for example, had this idea of trying to do some of this prediction, for which we got the Cray supercomputer, which was a total mess for a variety of reasons. And the CDOT system also failed, again, for a variety of reasons. I don't want to go into all those technical issues. What I'm saying is, compared to Australia, we had a technological solution. Why astronomy, why whatever, it was a traditional solution, did exist. Why have we completely abandoned it? Because monsoon prediction is a very difficult supercomputing problem even now. We can do short-term prediction. But long-term prediction, and we are talking of long-term, what is going to happen 20 years, 50 years, and so on. It is extremely difficult, practically. I mean, as of the moment, it looks impossible. So I'm saying that there is some alternative which we need to explore, which we have not done. That's all the point I was making. Thanks.
Can I reply to this?
Of course, of course. Okay, I was just going to, on a slightly lighter note, I was going to add that Professor Raju, thankfully, these cyborgs or androids will not need as much water as we do. So the technological solution is that these intelligent machines may gradually make us obsolete, and then they may not need water and food either. Anyhow, go ahead, Mr. Kundu.
There are two countries, smart countries that I visited. One, I'd like to mention Holland. And Holland, and it's 3 meter below sea level. And if they were not smart, they would not have existed as a country, because it would have all been flooded. Then they have two major rivers, Rhine and one more river which depouches there. And then they have floods in the North Sea. In 1953, they had a huge flood, and as a result, 30% of their GDP was gone. Their parliament sat down. They say that we will not allow this thing to happen in future. So normally when you designing for all these water projects, you have 1 in 100 year extreme events. So the extreme events, 1 in 100 years, you take 100 years. So that is basically you design with 99% this. They say 99% is not good enough. We need to design in 1 in 10,000 years, 1 in 10,000 years. So that for times to come, Holland is safe. So they started designing 1 in 10,000 years. So now almost every country is following it. When we build dams, we are following that, because And as I mentioned to you, Australia, 2000, they had a millennium drought, huge drought that they had. And then they realized they could not have survived as a country.
No lawns could be watered in Australia. And the amount of domestic water that any household could use was also rationed, though the populace is quite educated, so there was not really a surveillance regime, but everybody was told that per head you shouldn't use more than, I think, 50 liters of water or something. So if you're a family of four, you should only use 200 liters of water. And they went through their summer, which is like in our winter time, through the measures. Go ahead, sorry, now that you're on. Yeah, so, yeah, Mr. Kundo, go ahead.
Australia, what they have is, they have a custodian for a river. So the custodian basically ensures the flow and the environment of the quality of the river. So if I'm a city, say Melbourne, I go to the custodian. I say, I need to buy so much of water. They say, okay, we'll charge you so much for this. But then you need to treat the water and put it back to the river with this kind of standards. So water is actually, water has a price there. It's like we have value for land, you can sell and buy land. Similarly, water has a value there. So if I'm a farmer, he's a farmer, I don't want to cultivate this season, I can sell my water to him. Like you have tehsil and taluks in India, they have tehsil and taluks for water also. Now, I learned this, and water markets are now, because Australia started it, now they are in America, they are in US also, they are in China also. People found that this is very smart. There has to be value for water. You need to price water. And once I consume water, I need to put it back into the system with certain environmental quality. So we had this Upper Yamuna agreement. There were six member states, that is Himachal, Uttarakhand, UP, Haryana, Rajasthan, Delhi. We have 3.15% share of Upper Yamuna. Upper Yamuna is Yamuna till Okhla Barrage. And below Okhla is lower Yamuna up to Allahabad. We were not able to use it. So we put forth a proposition that we want to sell this water. And Delhi government, Mr. Kejriwal immediately bought this idea, because Delhi is water short. They said, we'll purchase it. So now they are giving us, we bargained and we got a good price for it. They're giving us 26 crore annually. When we build that Renuka Dam, we'll get double, say 56 or 60 crores. So there are smart things that are available. You need to price water. And the state should be able to trade water. If I have surplus water, Himachal did not need water because anyway it was flowing into Yamuna. So Delhi needs water, they can buy from us, but they need to pay a price for it. So I think technology, systems, methods, management are available. We need to take it forward. That's all.
Yes, obviously political will, bureaucracy, bureaucratic management, and of course, you know, the disempowered populace thinking that there's nothing they can do. That's why I brought in organizations like Swadhyaya and Swaminarayans, who've done a great deal of work in this matter. So they should also be brought in, because at the local level, they can be highly influential, and they have the resources to implement some of these ideas. I remember speaking with Pandurang Shastri Athavale Dada, and he said that he took a challenge. He told the district commissioner of Rajkot that we'll divide the district, half yours, half mine, and then set these goals, you know, millennium goals, 100% literacy, water management, you know, electricity generation, etc. And he said, after 1 year, let's compare notes. Which side succeeds better, you know? And at least we were told that the Swadhyay side did better than the government side, you know. Anyhow, I'm looking for more questions. I have another question from Dr. Srinivasan Iyer, which I'm going to skip because he's already posted three or four questions. Now, anybody else from among our fellows would like to ask a question? Yes, Alkaji, I see your hand. Go ahead. Unmute and speak, please.
Thank you. Mr. Kundu, for a very informative lecture. I wanted to ask you, like, how does this people's like traditional wisdom and technological advancement and technological advancement in this particular area, how much is government open to harness the traditional wisdom, and what steps do they take towards this? Because I remember the example of a river, you must have heard River Bay in Punjab, which was totally dead. It was revived people's movement there by a saint. You might have heard about this, because later he was like, you know, recognized by the government as well. So how open is the government to go to the people and actually harness the wisdom? That is the question.
Yeah, in fact, Rajendra Singh, another friend of mine who then got the Magsaysay Award, he started this Talab recharging movement, you know, that there are so many water bodies, smaller water bodies, which are dead, and then using traditional knowledge, desilting, also creating eco-friendly, non-porous, you know, talab or lake beds, etc. So both these questions are linked up, Mr. Kundu, please.
Madam Tyagi, thank you for this question. I think today it is well understood that traditional wisdom has to be preserved. And there was a lot of wisdom because people lived there. Say in Himalayas, you have bodies, springs. Some places you have tanks. Some places, Dr. Pranjpe mentioned, the tanks are very deep in Gujarat and parts of Rajasthan. It is well accepted that. Now, government also has a program in MNREGA. It's a huge program. And 50% of the funds are for water conservation. 50% of the funds, because it is sort of a labor intensive. So it is meant to give employment to local villagers, at the same time, create water assets. But the problem was that the left hand did not know what the right hand was doing. When we were in the ministry, it is not just by digging any well or digging any percolation well that the aquifer will get recharged. You need to have, this is science, and there is this traditional wisdom. These have to match. So we had a huge program where we sat down with the Department of Rural Development, Government of India, and said that just by building ponds, so ponds have limited capacity, you will not be able to recharge the aquifer. Aquifers are huge. They are like layers, no? So you need to improve your technology, and you need to know where to actually dig a well so that it percolates down to the aquifers. So today's technology and science has to match with basically traditional wisdom. Only then we will be able to solve the problem. And funds are not a problem. Government of India funds are not a problem. But ultimately, when you spend the funds, they should lead to water recharge. So this is what government is now trying to do, and they are basically patting the people for carrying on the traditional wisdom. But they have to have scientific inputs also. And this is extremely important. And if the aquifer maps are shared with the local population, where exactly the aquifer is, where you dig a well, then it can be charged. That has to be done. If that is done, I think we are on a path to success.
Thank you. I'm reminded of how when you want to dig a bore well, there are these water diviners, you see, that even today, despite our, you know, technological advancement, you get this water diviner, and often they are much more accurate than other people because they're not able to gauge, you see, where exactly to dig that bore well. So obviously, and Professor Raju also mentioned, our own calendar, unisolar calendar, was far more, I think, attuned to the cycles of nature. And you'll see that animals function according to those cycles. And we look at Gregorian months and often, you know, hopelessly get it wrong and get sick twice a year. But if you remember, at least in Delhi, that the hot season more or less is Holi to Diwali. And the day Holi finishes, you'll see that you don't need your sweater. You need to get... And the day Diwali happens, you need a sweater in Delhi at least. So these are very profound things. And in any case, India itself is going through a tremendous, I would say, parivartan, a tremendous churn. We have to discover ourselves, who we are. And though we want to be a part of the modern world, I think we have always tried, at least in our mainstream, Vivekananda, Gandhi, Tagore, you know, to have an alter modernity. We cannot do the modernity of the West. And as Mr. Kundu said, even the West, look at Spain, Australia, they're not into consumption and they're far more eco-friendly. When I was in Europe, I found members of parliament cycling to work. They don't have these hang-ups of 20 cars ahead and 5 cars, ye pilot car, ye wo. So we are in a state of churn, you know, there's a feudal mentality, there's a sector of our populace which is thinking ahead. And future thinking, thinking about futures, global futures, is I think what is going to unite human endeavor in the years to come. Because nation states can't solve problems because, you know, the problem arises in China and the flooding happens in India, for example. So these are very deep issues, and certainly, as Mr. Kundu said so correctly, water must flow. Rivers are living systems. The river is not dead. And what we see in the Ganga or even Narmada, I was shocked. I went to Omkareshwar and so forth. Just near the river, I went to the Ujjain, Simhastha during the Kumbh. Just before the river, they release some water. You know, it's a pretend river. There's a lot of patches of the Narmada which are practically dead. So there's so much thinking that needs to be done about this. And the river sutras are what bind our nation. We just had a conference on national integration. And we realized that ye jo tana bana hai, desh ka tana bana nadiyon se buna ja raha hai. So with these words, I just want to say one more thing, Mr. Kundu. You know the story, but when the British decided to make Shimla their summer capital, from the 1820s, they started coming here in the summers. But when they took it up seriously, they built this observatory house. It was built by Colonel, Bolu and his brother. They were both meteorologists and they had some trigonometric knowledge. They were surveyors. And they built that observatory on, you know, this is built on Observatory Hill. And our guest house, the observatory house was built, our observatory guest house was built where two watersheds, you know, merge, and one goes to the Arabian Sea, the other to the Bay of Bengal. So somehow IIAS is very deeply connected with the waterways of India. And I think the equipment is lost, whatever they had at that time. And then this became the Viceregal Estate later. But we are very grateful to you to have spared your time. And please do give us a write-up. We want to publish it in our journal. And we have a pre-publication plan, which with your slides, with your, you know, slides and explanatory notes, we can put it up on a pre-publication, readable but not downloadable section in our website so that the knowledge can be disseminated. With these words, I thank you again very much. And we look forward to your visit to the campus to guide us on how better to proceed with our water conservation efforts. And the last words, as usual, are yours, Mr. Kundu. Go ahead.
Thank you, Dr. Pranthwe. See, I'll thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to interact with you, though online. But today people say online is better because you can speak to people across geographies. But the hope is not lost. I'll just tell about this Kaveri issue, and it's just about 2-3 minutes. I have a lot of hope. I am a very optimistic person. This issue was about 150 years old since the time of Madras presidency. And because Madras presidency was so strong, it did not allow the other states like Mysore and Travancore and all that. But the problem was with us. When I joined the ministry in 2016, there were huge riots, as you mentioned, in Bangalore. A lot of people were killed, a lot of property was built. That year, the four states also love to fight. And they love to fight because there's a lot of optics with that. They spent 120 crores in litigation fees, four states, Kerala, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, and Puducherry, 120 crores in litigation. So when we got to do this case, finally, the case was in the Supreme Court. The total flow is 740 TMC, 1,000 million cubic feet. So the tribunal had only included 1/3 of Bangalore and Kaveri Delta, Kaveri Basin. The Supreme Court said that drinking water is a right, and we cannot exclude Bangalore from it. So they gave 14.75 TMC more to Karnataka. So that was the easy part. But Supreme Court said you frame a scheme. There is a Section 6 under the Act. You frame a scheme. That was a difficult part. So we did it. I remember I had done it. It was 14-page scheme that we had made. And there was a lot of jingoism going around that time in Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. This will not happen. This will happen and all that. Ultimately, we did this. And when I presented it to the Supreme Court did not even change a comma of that. And finally, it was implemented. And when we made that scheme, we sent it to the cabinet. And we wanted that scheme to be implemented before the onset of monsoon in 2018. The Prime Minister was on tour. He had gone for tour to 3 countries, Malaysia, Indonesia, Singapore. The file was sent to the Prime Minister. There is allocation of business rules and transaction of business rules. There's a rule, particular rule, Rule 12, where the Prime Minister in extreme emergency cases can dispense with the cabinet. We got the approval for the scheme from the Prime Minister when he landed in Singapore at 9:30 that day. And then we notified it. So things are possible. And we put an end and curtains to an issue which was 150 years old. And today we don't have fights and the scheme is working perfectly. So there was an issue. We were following two models, whether like Bhakra or we said we don't want to take control of all the water resources assets of the states because we don't want to run their water resource irrigation departments because all of them have different RNP rules. They are from different states. If you post someone from Kerala to Tamil Nadu, he'll never come. He says, you keep your dams, you keep your canals, but we will be in charge of control of water. Every drop of water, we'll be in charge. What you release, what you don't release will be done by the authority. And I am very happy to say that the scheme is in place. Last 2 years, there has been no water shortage and we have been able to set discipline in four states. And I'm very happy to be a part of that. But what I want to conclude is that everything is possible. A problem as complicated as Kaveri was also solved. So these are smaller problems. I think if we put the minds together and our thoughts together and our intentions together, I think we will be able to overcome this water challenge that we have in our future. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity.
Thank you, Mr. Kundu, on that optimistic note. Very glad that we had this Foundation Day distinguished lecture from you. And I hope that on this optimistic note, the next year of IIAS will also go well. I must remember our founders, President Radhakrishnan, whom I mentioned, but also a visionary education minister, M.C. Chagla. Muhammad Ali Karim Bhai Chagla was an extraordinarily, I would say, perceptive barrister. And incidentally, he was also the founder of JNU. And our first director, Professor Nihar Ranjan Rai. And there was a wonderful synergy at that time. And vice president at that time was Zakir Hussain, who then became president of India. So all these great people thought that this part of the presidential estate should be turned over to fellows who could do meaningful research on problems and concerns of humanity. And I hope that we can carry the torch forward another year. Thank you all very much. Thank you, Mr. Kundu.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Bye.